morning, church. It's a privilege to be with you, to worship with you. Good morning to those of you that are joining us on the online stream today. We are going to be continuing our journey this morning through the Old Testament book of Nehemiah. We're in Nehemiah chapter 8 this morning. We're going to begin our reading in verse 1. We're going to continue through the first half of verse 4, and then we're going to pick that up again in verse 8, and we're going to read through verse 12. And all the people gathered, as one man, into the square before the water gate. And they told Ezra, the scribe, to bring the book of the law of Moses that the Lord commanded Israel. So Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, both men and women, and all who could understand what they heard on the first day of the seventh month. And he read from it, facing the square before the water gate, from early morning until midday, in the presence of the men and the women, and all those who could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe stood on a wooden platform that they had made for the purpose. Verse 8. They read from the book of the law of God clearly. They gave sense so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra the priest and the scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, "This day is holy for the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people wept as they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, "Go your way, eat the fat, and drink the sweet wine, and send portions to anyone who has nothing ready, for this day is holy to our Lord. And do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." So the Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be quiet, for this day is holy. Do not be grieved." And all the people went their way to eat and drink, and to send portions, and to make great rejoicing, because they had understood the words that were declared to them. This is God's holy word. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you that you are not a silent God, that you have spoken to us. You're a God who has revealed yourself to your people, and your words shine light into our darkness. I pray that today that we would rightly hold as precious the gift of your holy word. I pray that your Spirit who inspired these words to be written would shine forth a vision of Christ in our hearts, so that in beholding Christ, we would be a transformed people, that you would form and shape us to be a people who are faithful to your mission. So, Lord, today would we encounter Christ, who is the Word become flesh. We pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. You can have your seat today. This fall at Redeemer, we have been exploring the Old Testament book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is a story of a great physical restoration of an ancient city. But it's also a story of a spiritual revival. It's a story that we've been laying on top of our own story as we have sought to be a people who faithfully love our city, the city to which God has sent us. We want to be those that press into restoration where there is brokenness in our city, but we also want to be a people who are faithful to our call as the people of God to be representatives, to be ambassadors of Christ's kingdom to a watching world. At the time of the story of Nehemiah, the time of exile has ended. The people of Israel once lived in a promised land where they had a kingdom, where they enjoyed great wealth, where they enjoyed great power, where they flourished for a great period of time. However, they fell into sin, and as a consequence, they were sent into the nations. They were sent into exile. And now we're at a period in history known as the post-exilic era. It's the era after the exile has occurred, and the people of God are returning to their promised land. The rulers of the Persian government have allowed the Jewish people to return to their ancestral homelands, but even though they're able to return to their promised land, their city, the city of Jerusalem, still lies in shambles. It is still vulnerable. It is still exposed to outside threats. And into this situation, Nehemiah, one of the greatest leaders of the Old Testament, comes into the story. He is a high-ranking official in the Persian government. And rather than enjoying his place of comfort and privilege, he actually chooses to press into the brokenness in the city of Jerusalem. He chooses to go to a place that is very vulnerable to attack. He chooses to expose himself to great danger to himself to be able to seek the restoration of of the great holy city. You see, Nehemiah, we have seen over the course of the series, is a deeply prayerful man. He's a deeply selfless man. And he is able, through his prayer, through his bold leadership, to unite the people of Jerusalem to rebuild the walls of the ancient city. And last week, as we explored the story, we witnessed the completion of the building project. The broken walls and the burnt down gates have been restored. The city that had essentially been in rubble for decades was actually restored in a period of 52 days. So powerful and so effective was Nehemiah's leadership. However, the story of Nehemiah is not over. And the mission has not yet been accomplished. Nehemiah has effectively led Jerusalem through the process of a physical renewal, but for the remaining chapters of this book, he will now focus on the spiritual renewal of Jerusalem. And this spiritual renewal, as we will see today, begins with and flows from the Word of God. The title of today's sermon is Renewed by the Word of God. And what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be talking about how the Word of God brings spiritual renewal in four ways. Number one, the Word of God brings about clarity. Number two, the Word of God brings about conviction. Number three, the Word of God brings about confession. And finally, the Word of God brings about covenant renewal. Point number one, the Word of God brings about clarity. After the wall is rebuilt, the people of Judah gather together within the city walls of Jerusalem. They stand before the water gate, and Ezra, this priest and scribe, stands upon this wooden platform, and he enrolls the law of Moses. He begins to read the words of Scripture. He begins reading in the early hours of morning, and he reads until midday. Oftentimes, I think we take it very much for granted how easy of access we have to the words of Scripture. If English was your first language, if you grew up in this nation, we take it for granted how easy it is for us to be able to have access to the Word of God. There are multiple wonderful English translations of Scripture that are available in print. In fact, we have Pew Bibles that, if you don't have one, that's your gift that you can take home with you today. You can have access to the Bible online. You can have access on a smart app that is free and gives you every translation that is essentially available. It really is amazing how much access we have to the Word of God. But there are many places in the world right now, and there have been many times in history, where God's people have not had easy access to the words of Scripture. You see, what's happening in Nehemiah chapter 8 for that reason is quite profound. The Jewish people have been in exile for decades. And before that time, the kingdom of Judah itself was in a place of long spiritual decline. It was a position in history where the Word of God was oftentimes minimized or flat out ignored, or if it was taught, it was mistaught. Now, here in this moment, the people of God are hearing the words of Scripture, some of them for the very first time in their lives. They're being told the story of their sacred history that had been neglected or long forgotten for generations. The people of God are finally being reconnected with the Word of God. And the Word of God is absolutely central. It is essential to the renewal of God's people, and there's a reason for that. It is essential to God's people because it's essential to their very existence. After all, Scripture reveals that God's Word spoke the cosmos into creation. God's Word promised the family of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that they would grow into a nation and that they would be given a promised land. God's Word, through His servant Moses, set the people of Israel free from slavery in Egypt and gave them the gift of God's law, constituted them as a nation. God's Word spoke through the prophets and prophesied of a day coming when an anointed Messiah would come bearing God's kingdom. And when that Messiah, our Lord Jesus Christ, came into this world, He lived a perfectly righteous life. He died the death we deserve, and He rose again. And when He ascended into heaven, right before He did that, He gave His church a mission to go and to make disciples of all nations. That is what God's Word does. The church, you need to see, is created by, it is constituted by the Word of God. And for this reason, we need the Word of God to renew us day by day and week after week. So when we read and we meditate on the words of Scripture, God is so faithful to renew us. When we gather together and we have the words of Scripture read over us and proclaimed to us, the Holy Spirit is faithful to form us and to shape us. Through His Word, God renews our sense of calling. Through His Word, God reminds us of our identity in Christ. Through His Word, He binds us together in community. Through His Word, He gives us focus and clarity for His mission as His people. We need God's Word. But that is a rather controversial, a highly contested claim to be able to make in today's society. To make that truth claim in the year 2021 is more controversial than it has been in other ages of history or other places on the planet. The notion that we can actually know and access truth through inspired divine revelation is a hotly contested idea in today's culture. We like truth. We prefer types of truth that we can manage with our own rationality. We prefer those types of truth that we can put under a microscope and be able to form and fashion according to our ingenuity. We like forms of truth that are dependent upon human rationality. And so we're increasingly allergic to the notion that God does speak truth to us, that He can speak truth to us. Because if God speaks to us, it means that His words possess authority. And our culture is suspicious of authority, is it not? We don't like people telling us what to do. We don't like people challenging us or confronting us or daring to correct us in any way. We value individualism. We value independence. And individualism and independence can be good virtues at times. But when they become ultimate values, individualism and isolation and independence can lead us to a place of self-deception and destruction, where we are curling along a road that will lead us to death, but we know no better. As the book of Proverbs reminds us, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way to death. Also, it says, whoever isolates himself, seeks his own desire, he breaks out against all sound judgment. Now listen, in a time when it has never been more easy to read books and blogs and articles and watch YouTube videos that do nothing but confirm your own bias, that do nothing but validate what you want to be true, we need God's Word to confront us. We need God's Word to tell us where we are walking in error. We need God's Word, a source of authority that is outside of us, to show us where we might be stumbling into error, to give us clarity where we might unknowingly be confused. This is why it is very notable that when Ezra reads the word of the law, and he's reading in Jerusalem, he is intentionally reading from a platform that is elevated and higher authority above God's people. Look at verse 5 of chapter 8. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people, and as he opened it, all the people stood. This is why, by the way, throughout all Christian history, when God's word is read and when it has been spoken in terms of corporate worship, it is oftentimes read and spoken from an elevated platform. It's not just so that the congregation can get a better view of the preacher. It is a visual display that God's word is an authority over His people, that His word reigns over us, that it is a source of authority that is above our own thoughts. For the same reason that we will oftentimes stand. We do that here at Redeemer Christian Church, and Christians have done that throughout centuries. When the Word of God is read, people will stand, acknowledging the authority of God's holy Word. We're saying with our bodies in that moment that God's thoughts are to be honored and respected as belonging to a different category than our own thoughts. That's why when we come before God's Word, we have to come with absolute humility. We're not to study God's Word through the lens of ourselves. We are to study ourselves. We are to study our own thoughts through the lens of God's Word. Because the words of culture that are around us, the words that are surrounding us in media and subcultures and different pressure groups, they are pressing in upon us at all points in time. That world offers us very different stories of how we can interpret our own identity and see our lives. And it's against that reality that the Word of God is able to recalibrate us, to live in light of a God who is holy, a God who is powerful, a God that is glorious, and to live in light of what He is doing in history. Point number two, the Word of God brings about conviction. There are a few clues in this chapter that the book that is being read by Ezra is the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy is, of course, one of the books of Moses. It's an essential part of the Mosaic Law. It contains specific instructions about how the people of God are to live, how they are to worship God. But there is one of the more memorable parts of Deuteronomy that appears in Deuteronomy chapter 28. And it is a chapter that is filled with words of blessing and words of curse. Essentially, God is saying, if you obey my commands, if you obey and live according to my instruction, I will bless you. I will cause you to be able to flourish in the land that I want to give you. I will protect you. I will defend you. I will be with you and among you and reveal myself to you. But if you forsake my commands, if you cast my instruction behind you, there will be consequences. You will walk down a road that will lead you to suffering. And you need to know what's going to happen before that happens. And now, for the first time in truly generations, the people of Jerusalem realize the reason they have suffered so much, the reason they have been sent into exile, the reason they lost their kingdom and their freedom, is because they sinned over and over again against the law of God. And as a result, they feel this weight of conviction. They feel for their sin. They witness and they acknowledge their sin and they grieve. Let's look back at our text in verse 9. And Nehemiah, who is the governor, and Ezra the priest and the scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, this day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept as they heard the words of the law. Something then happens. Ezra and Nehemiah refuse to allow this sense of conviction to leave the people of God merely in a place of despair. They have not gathered the people of God together to throw a corporate pity party with one another. They actually say something that might surprise us. Look at verse 10. Then he said to them, go your way and eat the fat and drink sweet wine and send portions to anyone who has nothing ready. For this day is holy to our Lord, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The Word of God does shine light into our darkness. It is a living sword that pierces our hearts. It exposes us where we are weak. It exposes us where we are in need and where we have sinned. In a word or simply said, it brings forth conviction in our hearts. However, I do think a lot of people have the wrong idea about what conviction actually is. We think conviction is a bad thing or a shameful thing. And so we have this visceral reaction that when we feel a sense of conviction, we run away from the feeling that maybe we have erred. Maybe we have done something wrong. Oftentimes we are tempted to, in fact, minimize or ignore hard truth if it brings conviction upon us or upon our group. But if we see it according to Scripture, conviction is not an ill omen that brings forth despair. Conviction is a gift that leads us into a greater joy. I think people get the wrong idea about conviction because they get it confused or conflated with condemnation. You see, conviction and condemnation are very different concepts. Conviction is simply saying, what you have done is wrong. You have sinned. You have done the wrong thing. Condemnation is what says you deserve to be punished. You deserve to be humiliated. You deserve to bear the weight of what you have done. The Holy Spirit is faithful, and he has a continuing role in the life of the believer to illuminate our hearts and to convict us of our sin, to convict us of the way that we should be going in life. But the Holy Spirit never brings about condemnation for his people. Do you know why? Because there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is no condemnation because Jesus Christ died for our sins. He took every single ounce of penalty and punishment upon himself so that we no longer have to bear the weight of our sin. And if that is true, we have no reason to fear conviction. We have no reason to be fearful of the Word of God exposing us or confronting us. Conviction simply breaks the spell that self-deception often has over us. Conviction exposes how sin only leads us to sorrow and death. Conviction is simply the voice of your Heavenly Father saying, my child, that road is going to lead you to pain. Here, come, let me show you the road that will lead you to joy in life. Conviction is oftentimes the first step of the truth setting us free. Point number three, the Word of God brings confession. The people of Jerusalem do not stop with conviction. They allow conviction to translate into action. And almost immediately, as they're reading and studying the law of Moses, they realize that there has been this feast that they have not celebrated as a people for centuries. And that feast is called the Feast of Booths, or the Feast of Tabernacles. And the feasts of the Old Testament law were important. They were a way that the people of God remembered their history. It was a way that they remembered their story, a way that they remembered their heritage. And this particular feast, the Feast of Booths or the Feast of Tabernacles, would be a time where the people of Israel would leave their homes and they would gather together. In this case, they gather inside the city of Jerusalem because there's a lot of wide open space inside the city walls. And instead of living in homes, they would live in tents, temporary dwellings that they would construct. And they would use this time for about a week where they would gather, they would read scripture, they would pray, they would rejoice, they would celebrate that this harvest was beginning to come in, and they would come together and they would remember this pivotal moment in their history when once they were not a people who lived in a promised land. They were a people who wandered in the wilderness. They were a people who lived in temporary dwellings. They were a nomadic people who depended upon God every single day to give them bread to eat. And in this moment, the Feast of Booths was designed to remind the people of God of their absolute dependence upon Him, why they needed their God, to never lose a sense of how much He has given them, how faithful He has been to them, and how much they still need to humble themselves before Him. But interestingly, even though that Feast of Booths was something that was commanded in the Law of Moses, it had not been done or observed since the days of Joshua. I mean, that was multiple centuries ago. That was so long ago that it was even centuries before the life of King David. And that shows us, I think, a rather haunting truth. When we get comfortable, when we get to a place where things are going well in life, it is so easy for us to remember that, you know what, I think I have this by myself. I think I can do this by myself. God, thanks for getting me there, but I don't need you anymore. It's easy for us to forget how much we truly need God when we are no longer desperate for Him. It's easy, in other words, to trivialize our worship of God when we are at a place of comfort and ease. But the people of Jerusalem actually are going to go a step further. They hold a sacred assembly, and they confess their sins. But not only that, they even confess the sins of their ancestors. Look at the beginning of chapter 9 of Nehemiah. Now on the 24th day of this month, the people of Israel were assembled with fasting and in sackcloth and with earth on their heads. And the Israelites separated themselves from all the foreigners, and they stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. The rest of chapter 9 is going to be this very long, beautiful, sincere, heartfelt prayer to God. And in this prayer, the people of Israel acknowledge how faithful God has been to them throughout the ages. They also recount all the ways that the people of Israel have sinned against God, and they confess that as a people, they need God. See, the word that was spoken to them in Jerusalem provides the people of God with their place in history. All of a sudden, they're able to see themselves inside of the story of God. They're able to see themselves in continuity with the people of God from generations past. They are able to see that as the people of God, they have this calling to be holy and distinct, but they have also oftentimes failed to live up to this calling. For the same reason, I think it is so crucial as a part of our spiritual discipline, corporately and privately, to remember the history of the people of God. That's why it's actually really important for you not to skip the Old Testament in your Bible reading. It's important for you to read the historical sections of Old Testament scripture because you know what? Those words are a pattern for the people of God today, the New Testament tells us. See, whenever you see the way that the nation of Israel was tempted towards sin and compromise so often, the exact same ways that we too today are tempted towards sin and compromise. That's why it's actually really helpful to read the gospel accounts and look at the ways when the disciples messed up, when they act really foolishly, when they misunderstand Jesus, and when they get Jesus wrong, because the same ways that the disciples were tempted to get Jesus wrong, we too are tempted to get Jesus wrong. That's why we need to read the letters of the New Testament, where the apostles are oftentimes redirecting or correcting the early church, because the ways that they messed up are the ways that we still mess up today. And the big idea from this is when we read the words of Scripture and when we see our own sin or our own mistakes revealed from the pages of Holy Scripture, we need to be bold and courageous enough to confess and to repent. Say, Lord, we've gone wrong and we need your help. We don't need to be afraid when Scripture exposes us. We don't need to be ashamed to come before God in prayer and confess our sins. You know why? Because when we come before our God and His throne in prayer, it is not a throne of judgment for His people. It's a throne of grace. As the author of Hebrews says, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. This is why all throughout the majority, the vast majority of Christianity and of the church, when the people of God gather together, there has always been a time in our corporate worship where we confess our sins, privately and corporately. It's only been very recently, and particularly in America, where we tend to get rid of that confession aspect of our service. And I think that tells us more about our culture than it does about Christian history. Confession is not a bad thing. It's not something that should fill us with dread. After all, confession is not an act of self-punishment. It's not an act of self-condemnation. Confession is simply laying down the burdens of your sin before the one who has invited the heavy laden to come to Him. Confession is simply coming into agreement with God about why we need His grace in the first place. And many times, if you do read and study Christian history, you will discover when sincere and humble confession are practiced by the people of God, that forms the very kindling of the fire of revival. Magnificent and supernatural things happen when the people of God lay down our pride and our pretense and we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. Point number four, the final point. The Word of God brings about covenant renewal. All of this deep interaction that the people of Jerusalem are having with the Word of God brings them to a very decisive action. They know, they understand, they realize that they must renew their covenant with God. Covenant renewal happens several times in the history of Israel. It happens right before they enter the Promised Land. It happens right after Joshua takes over and has a successful conquest of the Promised Land. It happens in these very crucial moments. And right now, as the people of God have re-entered into the Promised Land, as they have rebuilt the city of Jerusalem, they acknowledge their sin and they realize they must renew their covenant. Look at the last verse of chapter 9. They write, because of all of this, we make a firm covenant in writing. On the sealed document are the names of our princes, our Levites, and our priests. Now, when God delivered the nation of Israel out from Egypt, when He delivered them from slavery, He took them to a mountain called Sinai, and there He constituted them and consecrated them as a nation. And He did this by making a covenant with them. Now, that word covenant is a bit of an unfamiliar term to many people in our society today, but it is a very important term in the words of Scripture. A covenant was essentially a sacred and a sacrificial promise that was made between two parties. It was essentially the most binding form of promise that a person could make. And when God delivered Israel, when He set them free from slavery, He promised, or He covenanted, to be their God, to dwell among them, to faithfully be with them, to defend them, to protect them, to bless them, to reveal Himself to them. And Israel, in turn, covenanted to be a holy nation, that would live according to his promises, that would live according to his commands and obey his law. However, time and time again, Israel was faithless to the covenant of God. Instead of loving the God who had so faithfully loved them, they turned away from God. They trivialized the word of God. They ignored and deprioritized his worship. They built a society where justice was ignored and injustice was replete. They were seduced to worship the idols and the false gods of the nations that surrounded them. And when this happened, God eventually removed his blessing from his people. And they fell into suffering. And eventually they fell into exile. But now, in this moment, in Nehemiah, the people of God have seen their sin. They have confessed their sins. And they have even confessed the sins of generations that have gone before them. They have remembered their own story. And they have borne witness to the faithfulness of God. And now, they will recommit themselves to the covenant. They will renew the covenant that God has made with them. The fascinating thing is that that term covenant does not go away once we get into the words of the New Testament. In fact, it grows and becomes even more important. Because when Christ came, he didn't just extend the covenant. He didn't just extend a warranty. He inaugurated a new and a better covenant. When Israel had come out of Egypt, this covenant that God made with him marked the moment that Pharaoh was defeated and that the people were set free. But in the new covenant that Christ has made, it marks the defeat of the very power of death itself by the power of Jesus' resurrection. Whenever the new covenant was made by Jesus Christ, it commemorates that we are a people that has not just been set free from slavery to Egypt. We have been set free from slavery and the tyranny of sin itself. That's why, week after week, Christian worship has historically observed a covenant renewal ceremony. In fact, we do it every single week here at Redeemer Christian Church. There's a word for that. There's a term for that, and it is called the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is a ceremony, a sacred ceremony of covenant renewal. Every week, we remind our hearts that Christ has died for our sin, that he has risen in victory, and that as the ascended Lord, he is supreme over all rival powers, that one day he will return and make all things new. And when we share in the Lord's Supper together, we remind our hearts of that reality. The Holy Spirit faithfully over centuries has ministered to his people in that moment the truth that our Lord is faithful. In that moment, we are able to taste and see that he is good. People of God, we need the Word of God and everything that flows from it. The Word of God does renew us because ultimately the Word of God does not just reveal truth to us. It reveals the one who is truth. Jesus Christ is the eternal Word of God, the Word that became flesh and has dwelt among us. He is the radiance of God's glory and the exact imprint of his nature. He is the one in whom the fullness of the Godhead dwells in bodily form. When we encounter the Word of God with eyes unveiled by the Holy Spirit, we encounter Christ himself, and we are transformed more and more into his likeness. We are transformed from one degree of glory to another. So, Redeemer Christian Church, may we be a people who rightly treasure the Word of God. May we be a people that allow the Word of God to renew us day by day and form us into a people who are faithful to the mission we've been given. May his Word lead us evermore to Jesus Christ himself, who is the author and the perfecter of our faith. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you speak to us, that even though these words were written centuries and millennia ago, they are still relevant to us. They are still living. They are still active to us. And Lord, I pray that today you would remind us of how vital, how crucial your word is to our lives. Help us to be a people that are fearless to press into the conviction that your word inevitably creates. That we would be a people that eagerly press into your truth so that it might shine light wherever there is darkness in our hearts. That we would be a people set free in confession, that we would no longer be laden by our sin, day by day, week by week, we would be a people that remind our hearts of our story, of our heritage, of the covenant.